Welcome everyone. I'm Vincenzo Napolano, your communication responsible. I will in 2 seconds leave the floor to our director Stavros Castanevas and Paola Antolini. Just to say you that you have a button below your screen on the right when you can choose the language, English or Italian, that you prefer for following this event, this seminar today. And you can also ask questions in the D and R button that you have below your screen or even in the chat. So welcome to the Sound of the Universe, and please, Stavros.
Yes, welcome also from me, Stavros Castanevas, Director of European Gravitation Observatory. We're organizing this Researchers' Night together with the Museo della Grafica, and we have here Alessandro Tosi, who will close. So I thought he would close. I wanted to say two words, and I leave the floor to Paola to introduce our distinguished guests. We're really very proud to have them with us. So why Sound of the Universe? You may, of course, remember that 5 years ago, there was this detection of gravitational waves coming from the merging of two black holes. And this was a violent event that made according to the relativity of Einstein, made the space-time vibrate. This vibration came to us and we measured it in the American colleagues in the US and here in Pisa in the Virgo detector. We detected it as a signal, as an interferometric signal, as we say. You might see a few things later on about it, but which was essentially the change of the distance of two mirrors kept in a very, very precise distance. It was like a tuning fork that got these vibrations of the universe. So that's why these vibrations were for us in the what we call the frequency range, the acoustic frequency range, which is for the experts from 10 hertz to 10 kilohertz. That's why we called it hearing the sound of the universe. I say very often that Pascal, the philosopher, was saying that silence of these eternal spaces frightens me. And so we tell him where he is. We tell him, don't be afraid, Pascal. We even heard the sound of the universe because we've heard these vibrations. This is the first message. The second message is that now, this also was characteristic of something else. There was a movement in the middle of the previous century to extend the ways we see the universe. We saw it, we're seeing it mostly through the optical, the infrared, the UV. But then slowly, after the First World War, the Second World War, I'm sorry, we started seeing through radio. Then we went up in space in the Sputnik era. We started seeing it with X-rays, with photons. And then we started looking in 1987, we saw a supernova also in neutrino. And 5 years ago, we saw it with gravitational waves. So it started what we call the multi-messenger astronomy and astrophysics, which means you understand the universe not only with one sense, but you can make, again, it is a metaphor. I'm not saying that we're, you know, smelling or listening to the universe, but you use more and more messengers to understand what's happening. And this is extraordinary. This is inspiration for the great artists we have with us. It is also inspiration for us. And it says something about humanity, that humanity does not use only light, uses also sound to understand, uses all the senses. And this is a message how we increase our perception, our cognitive perception, cognitive understanding of the universe using these messengers, but also how we can be inclusive. People that, for instance, do not see can contribute. And here we have one of the leading persons in this movement to how you put sound in the messages. So this is a very short things I wanted to say, of course, and just wanted to thank you again for joining. I see you are 150, and that's really nice, more than we could have you in the Ego auditorium. And I pass the words to Paola to introduce our distinguished guests. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Stavros. Thank you to all the distinguished guests to be with us. Thank you also to our listener community that soon will become a talking community as well. And I just want to present very shortly, because then you will appreciate him directly. The next speaker is Yves Langevin, which is a bright planetologist. Here for Bright Night, we only have bright minds, let's say. So he will explain us how the planet talk to us if we decide to accept this poetic invitation and game. And after, you know, if we want to quickly go to the origin of the European Researcher Night, just a few words, is more than, since more than 10 years that for the European Researcher Night, the 300 towns in Europe open up their labs and observatory, inspired by the Marie Curie engagement for the civil society, science and civil society. So Yves Langevin, he has many qualities as a planetologist, and also from the anthropological point of view, from his mother line, he is a grandchild of Marie Curie, which is also a special good quality. Voilà, but I give the floor to Yves Langevin. I just want to say that we have other wonderful lady, that is Wanda Dia Merced with us. And then we will have Bernard Foin, which is a specialized on moon exploration. Then the excellent artist Lilian Lynch, and then the scientific director of the Graphic Art Museum in Pisa, which is Alessandro Tosi. Then we have the astrophil community, Domenico Antonacci, and other surprise. So stay with us, and you will be amazed. As Aristotle was saying, there is only knowledge when there is amazing fact. So Yves, thank you for your talk. The planet and as well the space dimension.
So we try to tell you a little bit about how the planet, to get the planets to talk to us. Of course, the main topic is the sounds of the universe. So let's talk a little bit first of what it means when you talk about the sounds of the planets. First of all, as you all know, sound, it's a pressure wave traveling through a gas. In that respect, planetary science has a really wide range of an environment to play with, because 7 of the 8 major planets have atmospheres, have gases around them. The only one which doesn't is Mercury, the one closest to the Sun. And even more interesting, there is also a satellite of Saturn, Titan, which also have an atmosphere. And actually, why this one has an atmosphere, no other satellite. This is really a major puzzle. Then when you think about sound, sound is a combination of two things. First of all, you need some pressure to get your eardrums to hear something. And the second is, of course, what kind of turbulence, wind, or whatever is there in there. So first of all, if you look at the planets or satellites, you can see that the range of pressures is extremely wide. On Mars, it's very, very small. It's only 6 millibars, much smaller than the Earth. Then you have the Earth, of course, at 1 bar, but also Titan, which has 1.6 bars, and this satellite has an atmosphere which is very close to that of the Earth. It's also nitrogen. It's really very puzzling. And then when we go to other objects, you end up with very large pressures, 90 bars for Venus, and of course, giant planets, there are atmospheres all the way to the center, and then can go up to megabars. So the range of pressure is really immense. When you think about wind speeds, it's also really very broad. When Huygens went down to Titan, it found really high winds at the top of the atmosphere, but very, very small winds at the bottom. It's very quiet down there. Mars is pretty active, 100 kilometers per hour. And then you have the Venus cloud layer, which has also very strong winds, 300 kilometers per hour. And giant planets is even worse, 600 kilometers per hour. That's three times a major hurricane of the Earth. So what that means is that if you think about the sounds of the planet as waves traveling through gas, you end up going from whispers on Mars, and you have the two next missions, which are going to be launched pretty soon, Mars 2020 and ExoMars, which will go there with rovers so that we can listen something. And then for Titan, we have a really fascinating NASA mission to be launched in 2025 with a kind of helicopter flying on Titan. That will be really puzzling. And then if you think of the other planets, you have deafening holes. Your ears would not survive a fraction of a second with that kind of sound waves. There is another type of sound which you can listen to in planets, which is seismometry. There, the pressure waves travel through solids, through the crust of the planet. And this is much lower frequency. Stravros was mentioning that kind of things as well for star seismology, which you can hear from Ego. Up to now, you have only two planets which have been listened to with seismometry, which is the Moon and Mars. Mars actually had the first seismometer in 1976, but unfortunately, it was too high above the ground, and it actually was very good at picking winds, but not seismic. The first one to do that is in operation since last year, it's InSight Seism. I will now go to another type of music, which is what happens when you listen to radio emissions. This is really a very diverse field. In particular, you have the kilometric emissions from aurora, which you have on many other planets than the Earth, on Mars and many on Jupiter and Saturn and the giant planets. And what is interesting is that these emissions have also frequencies which are in the hearing range. As mentioned by Stavros, 20 Hz to 20 kilohertz, you can see the frequency there for the Earth. It's really very complicated. And this is what is called a time frequency diagram. It's a musical score. It's basically all the sounds, all the frequencies as a function of time. And if you think of it about music, if you translate these frequencies into sound, you have extremely different tunes from the Earth or from giant planets. You can see that when you compare the top chart, which is from the Earth, and the bottom chart, which is Jupiter, with these things there, kilometric radiation, which are in the hearing range. I will give you an example with Saturn. The instrument is RPWS, which is a radio wave experiment. I hope I will be able to start it. And you will see this is some kind of motion. It's a bit tweak. I think that's about, so you can see this is some kind of whale song, really very bizarre, but really very nice. I like it a lot. Now we'll broaden a bit the scope by, as you have seen from these previous examples, we get a lot of information from planetary missions. And for us, planetary scientists, this is the best way to get the planets to talk to us. Why is that so? First of all, you have much higher spatial resolution than you can get from the Earth, whether from the ground or from space, even very big space telescope cannot do as much as we can do when we're close to the planet. And then you can also have in situ modules. You can put landers, rovers, balloons. I mentioned already for Titan, we can also have a helicopter. And you can go all the way to sample returns so that you can really bring material from a planet to the laboratory. This is now available for the moon, of course, Apollo, but also asteroids, two missions underway, and a third one which collected a few micrograms. And then we can hope a sample from Mars in the 2025-2030 right region. I would like to point out, taking the chance of being in Italy, that actually Italy has become one of the leading nations in the world for planetary science. And in particular, there is a very strong participation in European missions. In that respect, I would like to mention the leading role of a very good colleague and friend, Giorgetta Corradini, which left us in 2011, and which really played, of course, this is a community effort. She was not alone, but she was really a leader in this effort. Italy was not that strong in 1980 when I started my career, and now it's among the leading nations in Europe and even in the world. This is in part thanks to a political support in Italy, which was actually quite consistent in very difficult political situation. And so support for space had been very consistent in Italy. I mentioned, unfortunately, for research positions, the policy has been slightly less consistent with kind of stops and goes, which are not very good for young people. I will just finish by mentioning that there are three major European missions which are already launched or soon to be launched with a strong Italian involvement. The first one has been launched in 1918 in October. It was a very beautiful launch in Kourou. It's really, if you have the chance to see a night launch, go there. It's really very, very impressive. You are in full day in the middle of the night, and the sound is really nice. So this is a collaboration between Europe and Japan. It goes to Mercury. It uses high-end propulsion, which is a very advanced technology. You have two polar orbiters. The launch has occurred about 2 years ago. We have no nominal in-flight operations up to now, and macro-orbit insertion is in December 2025. Actually, Beppe Colombo takes his name from an Italian scientist, Giuseppe Colombo, which passed away in 1984, this guy was able to convince NASA they could do three flybys of Mercury with a mission in 1976. And I can tell you, I succeeded as well in some other missions. Convincing NASA that you have something to teach them is not always obvious. So the next one I would like to mention is JUICE, a mission to the Jupiter system. You have a lot of flybys of Galilean satellites. We learn a lot about whether there is liquid water inside these icy moons, whether that a possible habitat for exobiology. That's really very interesting. It's not very soon, it takes time. The science mission is from 2030 to 2033. And to give you an example of the Italian role in there, 10 science payload instruments, and Italy has the leadership for 3 out of 10, and a major contribution to the imaging spectrometer, which is French-led. I was a PI until 6 months ago. The last one I would like to point out is ExoMars. This is really a major mission. Actually, this rover is called Rosalind Franklin, from the lady which should have had the Nobel Prize together with Crick and Watson for finding out the ADN. This is a collaboration between Europe and Russia. It's very complicated. As you know, Europe and Russia have some difficulties with Ukraine and things like that. There are also technical difficulties. The launch is in September 2022. It takes much less time than for Jupiter. We arrive less than 1 year later. And this mission was funded at 33% from Italy, which is, of course, a very large contribution, because the GNP of Italy within European member states is about 14%. So you have a beautiful artist view of ExoMars coming down on the surface of Mars with a platform from Russia called Kanachuk, and the ExoMars rover, which are rolling down. You can see it going down the ramp and beginning to explore whether you had ancient fossil life on Mars. And with that, I will stop. I need to stop sharing. Here you go. Paola, next one.
Yes, thank you so much, Yves, for this beautiful presentation. So we enter into the space dimension, well, where we will stay. Just one appreciation for the future debate. My first question will be, yes, the planet are talking to us, but what can we understand from their language? The music was really beautiful, but this might be then the beginning of the debate. Thank you so much, Eve. Then I noticed that we have 166 persons connected and already many questions. So we try to have a certain equilibrium and to have one speaker and also one video. I see that Wanda is ready, but I just want to remind you what is the origin of the Bright Night acronym. You know, it's very challenging, it's brilliant, and we are brilliant researcher. Impact on growth, health, and trust in research. So here we are with all these bright researchers. Thank you, Eva, for this beautiful presentation. And I would give the floor to Wanda, or we have the video before.
No, sorry for interrupting. Just a second. I want just remind in Italian to our public how to follow the translation, because I've seen many questions about that. Quindi per tutti, in basso a destra, di fianco al pulsante condividere lo schermo, c'è un pulsante in cui è possibile scegliere la lingua e ascoltare la traduzione simultanea in italiano. Scusate, non l'ho detto prima in italiano. Se non vi riesce, dovreste aggiornare la vostra versione di Zoom. Sorry for this interruption, Paola, but I needed to share this info with the Italian speaking public. Please, thank you.
Yes, the logos as the shape of the word with the meridian and parallel, so it's easy to find out. What about the question we would ask?
Slides, yes. Yeah, we will put the slides, we will inform, or we have the registered people and we will send the slides. We'll put somewhere and have the slides available.
Yes, thank you. So we continue with the Wanda and then we take the question. It's like this, or we want to have a refreshing video, 3 minutes. What do you think, Valerio?
Can you show Valerio the?
We have Rafael Dalla Porta, which is an artist, because we are the sound of the universe with the art and science. So we have this GW181124, 3 minutes video, refreshing, and we also welcome Bernardo.
Just only. A few words about this video. This video was made inside the Virgo interferometer, and it was an idea of Rafael Dalla Porta, that is a French photographer, French artist, that essentially hired two musicians, and one of these two musicians is also a composer, and they essentially play a piece of music composed by one of the two musicians, Christoph Maratka, inside the main building of Virgo interferometer, and also the effect on the sound on the interferometer was detected and collected by us. So it was a sort of collaboration between science and art to produce the video that I will show you. Well, you will see the inner side of the detector, the inner part of the detector, and the two musicians playing.
Thank you.
Okay, we can go. I hope you enjoyed it. We can go ahead.
Yes, thank you for this beautiful, refreshing video and composition, musical composition. What I also would like to say is that this year, shortly, for the European Researcher Night, which has been inaugurated today at 4 o'clock, and for the social impact, we would like also to say that this year, in this special Renaissance spirit, this European Researcher Night, Bright Night, is dedicated to the Agenda 2030 of the United Nations and to the Sustainable Development Goals. May I say that with Stavros and the ECO community, we have chosen the Sustainable Development Goal number 4. That's also the reason why we are here stronger together, which is inclusive quality education. And this way of the inclusive quality education, top quality, as the presentation of Yves, and we will see also with the presentation of Wanda Dia Mercedes, is our purpose. So to have an education without border, an education where everybody is considered, and where, as Wanda will explain us, even an astrophysicist of her talent can invest a lot of her time and of her energy to have an inclusive and top quality education. So you are mythical, Wanda. Thank you for being with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you very, very, very much to all of you. Can you hear me okay? Is the sound flowing okay?
Yes.
Okay.
It's just your eyes. I cannot see your eyes. Maybe you are too high for us. Voila.
Okay. But, yes. like that? Okay.
Perfect.
Okay, I do apologize, forgive me. Thank you very much to Igo for this initiative tonight, for pioneering or organizing a night dedicated to the sound of the universe. I have never witnessed the like of it before. And I can tell humbly that by doing this, Igo, Virgo, Italy is leading the direction of the future. Thank you very much. Perhaps you already know that at the end of the 1800s, the rendering of information using audio in space science, we were already listening to the data, audifying the data, or directly translating a data waveform to the audible domain. So people would put antennas outside, they would detect signals, not from outer space, from high parts of the atmosphere, sometimes the exosphere, and they would make interpretations based on what they would hear in the data. Examples of this, and you are seeing on the first slide some references from Cassini and other contemporaneous detections that have been documented, real detections that have been documented using audio. For example of this in the past, at the end of the 1800s, were Dr. Bart Hansen, Dr. Halliwell, that were studying phenomena called whistlers from very high parts of the atmospheres. Please pay attention that the name they used was based on a contextual experience. Whistlers, chirping, ringing, as it was perceived by the ear. Dr. Story in 1935, if I'm not wrong, I do apologize for not remembering well, also wrote a very, very extensive thesis on how he used audio to study whistler mode emissions. Dr. Gournet, later on, in the 60s, 70s, Bobby Candy at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center also, he was really, really, really keen on using sound in order to analyze the data that was stored in the Space Physics Data Facility of the Space Organization in the United States. So I'm talking about the late 1800s, the 30s, also Jansky, which I forgot to mention, who using audio. He discovered the galactic background. So I'm talking about the 1800s, the 1950s, the 1930s, but it was not until 2013 that when we were investigating why space science is not using audio or sound for the study of data. Is it because it has been proven that audio worsens the exploration of the data. So investigating if visual modalities were better than other sensorial modalities for the exploration of astrophysics data, we just designed perception experiments. And we evidence that the use of sound increases the expert astronomer's sensitivity to events in the data that by nature are blind to the human eye. The experiments, as I said, to underline, were carried on experts, astronomers, and they were screened. They had no disabilities. They were screened for field of view sensitivity. Also, they were screened so they would not have any neurological challenges. Also, they were screened, they were very, very detailed. They were screened so they would not have any perception of the nose during routine tasks. We, for these experiments, what we did, pass to the next slide, is that we simulated a task. So it was not just anything, we simulated a task that derived from the notion that that there is a black hole in the center of galaxies. As you may be seeing in the slide, the molecular gas around the galaxies emit a double thick symmetric spectra. And you may see that I think it's below the the artistic rendering of the galaxy. So it emits a double peak symmetric spectra, and that is a task that we use to carry for the detection of black holes. So it is by identifying that double peak symmetric spectra that we identify candidate galaxies, and we use to perform hunches, go no go decisions, and we the symmetric spectra, the double peak symmetric spectra, maybe anywhere on the visual image that you saw the spectra, it may be anywhere, and also the signal to noise ratio may vary. And we simulated that dynamically, varying the position of the symmetric spectra, and also dynamically varying the signal to noise ratio. The better you get at identifying signal, the worse the next one would be. It would be, when I say worse, is that it would be more difficult for you to identify. So we evidence that when these expert astronomers were using sound, their sensitivity to the symmetric spectrum, their sensitivity to identify signal in the data increased. The question then is, why did we stop using audio in order to analyze the data if it increases the sensitivity of astronomers to events in the data that by nature are blind to the human eye? Because yet as 2020 or almost 2021, it did not evolve as traditional visual displays have. It is not clear right now why the field stopped. Just let's underline why the field stopped using other sensorial modalities, or why the vocabulary hasn't dynamically evolved to the emergence or the generation of experiential terms associated to the experience of the researcher when identifying signal. So that is a big question, why we keep using the same uniform human, cognitive, expressive, and reflexive transactions and interactions to explore outer space. One of the guesses is that it may have stopped due to lack of experimental evidence. We were able to provide a little bit of perceptual evidence. Some other people may have to do experiments, and I'm grateful to reinforce the proposal at Virgo that will generate more evidence, perhaps because of learning curve, the slow progress on audio resolution. But what is clear right now is that most sighted people that are doing space science and doing astrophysics today, they use their eyes to make sense of the conscious living world. And they are a very tiny minority, right? We want that to change. We want a majority of people enjoying this data. And visual perception has become the prevalent human sensorial modality used to make conscious of the astronomy information. What happens is, right, that we are not, as technologies have evolved low, but we have the experimental evidence. What we are proposing is not to use sound as a means to display only information. We want to use sound to enhance the amount and quality of information we can extract from the data. Another reason, and I'm going to bring this to you as a comment, is that the way audio has been treated by the mathematics, and that by the people studying hearing, also has had a big influence in the way audio has been treated. It's different from music listening or from musicalization listening, because harmonic expectation factor does not exist in this data. And in the course, perhaps you may know that the course of the 19th century, when the emergence of the Fourier theorem, it stated that theorem, it states that, and please correct me if I'm wrong, that any periodical function with periodic duration can be described as the sum of sinusoidal functions. And this was widely applied by physicists and astrophysicists in their studies, and we still use Fourier transformations. That Fourier theorem also became a keystone of modern hearing theory. And the attention of the people studying hearing became focused on considering how sinusoidal tones were denoted as pure tones, or how those tones were perceived, how those sinusoidal tones were perceived. But in nature, the reality is that the tones are not sinusoidal. And that is the reality. That is the reality of it. But the fact that those tones were not sinusoidal was not considered, with the consequence that so basic aspects like pitch, volume, timbre received almost no treatment or attention, right? What combinations may hinder, what combinations may increase perception? And most of the time is giving the impression that hearing is entirely determined, as Stavros said at the beginning, by auditory processes in which stimuli is translated into sensations. But this is not the case. The perception process yields not only to sensations of an incoming stimuli, but also it yields to interpretation, which is conscious or unconscious, to interpretation in the context of previous experience. Without the later aspect, our perceptual abilities will be limited if we don't use that context. So hearing includes both audition and cognition. It's very, very, very important, because cognition refers to the interpretation of the output of the activities of the hearing stimuli that we are receiving. That means that perhaps audition and cognition should not be understood as different stages of hearing, that they have to be considered together. And I enjoyed when Stavros used the word cognition at the beginning. Thank you so much. So what I find useful, and we go to the next slide if possible. What I find useful for space science is that electromagnetic waves, they spread. And when they spread, they propagate. And when they propagate through a medium that fluctuates or is random in composition, like outer space, the waves that travel through that medium, as they interact with the different fluctuations in the medium, they may be reflected, they may change direction, they become more tenuous, they more and more and more and more things. And according to that interaction, those fluctuations, one can deduce what is happening in the media. And regularly we do that with very sensitive telescopes, gathering light or gathering particle velocities, et cetera. And those changes in the media, in those interactions, we use the name as refractive index. That means how the flow of that energy changes as it passes through the different conditions in the media, how it interacts with the media. And studying that refractive index on how that energy changes, again, I'm going to repeat it, as it travels through the media and interacts with other things, whether they are particles, dust, magnetic fields. It may be, for example, accelerate other energetic particles and other things. And these fluctuations will result in changes in wave characteristics, like amplitudes or how high the wave is, and frequency, or how many times an oscillation repeats, etc. And those are easily perceptible with the ears. So that modulation, or that traveling of the wave and the changes through the media, was possible to hear it with, let's call it, a trained ear, by listening to those amplitudes or the power of the signal related to its frequency, as the first speaker mentioned in the beginning. And that in physics is called a power spectra. So that power spectra will give you the amplitude or the power of the signal related to its frequency. I have to repeat that. How the power or that amplitude is distributed over frequency, and we call it power spectra. So I'm going to give you a sample of a data, right? I heard data. Can you change the slide to the sounds if you're on the third slide? Hello? No. Okay. So I'm going to play some data, yes, and we will play that is. Okay, we are on the third slide. We will play the other sound, not that one. Please do not play it. Do not play it right now. I will kill you. Okay. So I heard this data. This is a power spectra. What you will hear, is data from a spacecraft. No. Thank you so much. May you stop it.
Start by itself. Not my.
May you stop it?
Yes, I'm trying.
Yes.
But what I can.
Voila.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Okay. Forgive me. So where were I? Describing. Yes. Forgive me. So this power spectra. I converted into sound and I focused on low frequency variations. In the case of hearing, how the lower tones, harmonics, intervals I heard were changing. And listening to that, what I focused was to be able to relate how the flux of that light was changing as it was passing through the media, or the spectral index, as I explained it a couple of times before. So I converted that into sound. Took data from cosmology data and data from the solar wind, how they were interacted. And I focused, right, on how that energy was changing. I heard to the register space, relative high or low frequency of discrete or noise sound. And how the notes were the product of several frequencies, harmonics, harmonic to subharmonic ratios, fundamentals, etc. I portrayed the fluctuation information as simultaneously sounded cluster of pitches. I heard the power spectra, and what you will hear, we will play only like 10 seconds of the data, is descending tones in the power spectra. That is very difficult to see because the power spectra sensorially is like when you touch a brush and you take a brush, you put it with the filaments up, and then you touch the brush visually is like that, but sensorially to the touch, just imagine that you're touching the filaments of the brush, and then suddenly one of the filaments just diminishes a little bit. It's very hard to see in that sea of spikes. So we will play the second sound.
Yes, please.
Which is wind ACE. I sped the sonification because it's thousands of data points. So let's just play it and I'll finish right now. So the media gets more dense, right? As the particles interact. And as that density increases, the exchange of the particles increases, what you will hear is a dip in the data. It becomes more turbulent.
Yes.
Is that okay? Stop it.
No, you have it, Wanda. You have your headphones on, so I mean we don't hear anything, I think.
Oh, but Vincenzo was up to play it.
He got
sound, Vincenzo. Only 9 seconds, and pay attention to see if you hear the dip. I explained it really why, because yes. You're running out of time. Wind ACE. So keep track of how the sound is evolving. It's mapped in volume, so you will hear. I'm not supposed to tell you this, but. Forgive me for the noise outside. Can you hear it?
Raise your microphone. Raise the volume of the microphone. We don't hear it very well.
Okay, I'll play it on my side, Vincenzo. Don't worry. I'll play it on my side. I apologize. I have a noise there at the background. Forgive me.
Don't worry.
But what you were up to here is how the refractive index was increasing. So with a big decrease on the yes. Which is very hard to see. Meaning that particle wave interaction or the physical implementation of transport of energy from the sun change is how it is changing, right? As it interacts with the cosmic waves. And I do apologize, but I've been for more than 15 minutes. Sorry, the sound didn't play. I thought Vincenzo already had it. Forgive me. So I want to thank you for carrying this first ever research night dedicated to the sound of space. And really, I would never thought I would witness anything like this before. Thank you. I do apologize, the sound of the power spectra did not play. Forgive me.
Thank you, Wanda, for this beautiful presentation. We are looking forward. Yes?
I think it's my time to present, while I leave, Vincenzo, who will show the next video, which is again from the exhibition we made for the Rhythm of Space, Il Ritmo dello Spazio, Museo della Grafica. It will be by Thomas Saraceno. Because before saying that, anyway, I wanted to say to the auditors, just look at the name of Wanda, Diaz Merced, and then you will see a lot of interesting talks about her work of audification, or sonification. TED talks, many talks that, you know, show her work on this. It's not just, you know, she's leading a movement, and we are really very proud that starting the next year, she will be with us as a, let's say, she will be one of us working here. And hopefully it's just the beginning. We can do many more things together around this. So the next thing is I will present, and it will be very short. It's 1.5 minutes. It is this work that it was in the Museo della Grafica. The dimensions of it were 6 meters by 3 meters, so you will not see that. It was fantastic, little children in front of it and things like that. And it's called The Politics of Solar Rhythms, or Cosmic Levitation. And what you will see, it will be sound coming from below. And of course, as you've heard by Yves Langevin, sound is pressure waves. So the pressure waves modulate the dust. And the dust, you will see it in front of your eyes, gathering, making you could see planets. So you see something where it is dust and rhythm. Together, they construct structure. And we had a philosopher with us, Heinz Wiesmann, that said that even Democritus, that we think that everything comes from particles, for Democritus, the atoms were not only particles, they were also rhythms. They were modulations of the field. They were called rhythmic, trope. It was so both, if you wish, vibration, sound, and particles were making the universe together. So I let you see how it is. It was, I think you just get a glimpse of what it was. So, Paola, it's for you.
It's beautiful. And I remember when we saw it on the full screen at the Museum of Modern Art in Paris, Palais de Tokyo. Thank you, Stavros, for this beautiful dialogue, art and science. So, and thank you for giving us all the chance of being more attractive, thanks to this equilibrium between art and science for education. So I would give the floor, with your agreement, with Bernard Fouan for traveling to the moon, as we did last year at La Sorbonne.
Hello, have a good day, everybody. So, way somewhere there's music. Oh, find the tune. Somewhere there's a heaven. How high the moon. And there is no moon above when love is far away too. So yes, we are going to talk about sounds and songs and signal from the moon. And so I would like to present on behalf of a large collaboration we call Art Moon Mars, what type of sounds we could make on the moon. And now we are going to embark you on a journey of the science, sound, technology, sound, but also what life could look like with all our team, which includes a young professional of a diverse origin. Indeed, we went to the moon. And we went to the moon with our first probe of the Millennium, Smart One, that we launched in 2003. And I'm the father of it, but we have also some good partners of Smart One, which are in the audience. And so we went there, we traveled to the moon with Europe. When we traveled to the moon, we tried to look from the moon what it tells you about the rocky planet. So what is the story about rocky planet? What makes them wrinkled? What makes them having craters? Are there volcanoes on them? We even explored regions, very cold one at the pole, that contain ice and permanent shadow. And indeed, we even make some quite a bang on the surface of the moon when we impacted it with our spacecraft at the end of life. Eventually, we explored the polar region of the moon and we found places where in the future we want to live. At the South Pole, for instance, where we can see the Earth 2 weeks per month, and also in areas where there is some deposit of ice. We even found a place on the moon, which is a peak of eternal sunlight. That's where we would like to establish a robotic relation and a moon base. So after that, after this first spacecraft, you could say full of a musical instrument that went to the moon, Smart One, we had a full orchestra, with many orchestras that went to the moon with an orchestra from China, Chang'e 1, the spacecraft, and then from Japan, Kaguya, we had the Indian, and also we had American mission that went there and are still in operation. So the idea is that we are going to establish a permanent outpost and humankind will be there. So we will have a phase with precursors in orbit, that's what we have done. We will have a surface robotic village, and then we'll have a sustainable permanent base with some humans, some robots, but also some benefits from people from Earth. De facto, this robotic village has started. In 2013, our Chinese friend has sent a lander and a rover. You can see here the logo of the company, the People's Republic of China, a big rover, which contains a number of instruments, not musical instruments, but they deliver to a signal that you can interpret to know better about the moon. Even ourselves in Europe, we are developing some landers, some intelligent rovers that could explore. Here's the one that we have in Etna. In the future, we'll go not only with robots, we'll go also with humans. So we have a program with NASA, with an Orion capsule. We sent 4 astronauts in 2023, and we use European service module to bring this astronaut around the moon and back. And eventually, after 2024, there could be even the first women on the surface of the moon. So that's our vision, a sustainable presence on the moon. And for this, we have various challenges to go there, to operate, communicate, send a signal, also survive in a good comfort and explore around with human robot. We will use also the resources that are there. And we will try to use the moon as a research base, but for the benefit of everybody, for science, technology, for developing a new, some innovation, even some business, and for as a renaissance for everybody of us. So de facto, we have started to prepare ourselves of what will be our life on the moon. So we build a little moon module here. You see, I lock my students for one day into this mini habitat, and they train how to communicate, how to make experiments from the moon. We also built a lander. We operated with astronauts. And we even had a program with a network of laboratories from universities in Europe where we built a moon habitat under the ice in a glacier in Switzerland. So here you can see we brought some rover, we grew some plants, we have some artificial intelligent gardener, and we even brought there even a gallery of art. We also explore areas on Earth that look like the moon. This is like Iceland. We went into lava tubes, which also exist on the moon and could protect you from radiation and from meteorites. In Poland, we have built also a moon base, and you can use it. Actually, you can book your travel to the moon there for 2 weeks. We isolate the astronaut for 2 weeks. Look, they are smiling. This was before the campaign, and even after, they were full of enthusiasm. Because we fed them with beautiful plants and with music to give them a good comfort of life. More recently, we developed a base in the top of a volcano in Hawaii, where, for instance, we have conducted some campaign. We deployed some rovers, some we analyzed samples. So we try to understand the story from all these rocks that we tell you about the story of Earth and of the moon. So here, for instance, you can, at a distance, comfortably, you can be in the mission control and listen to all the signals from the moon base, or you can go inside the moon base and you can share the life from this astronaut with research, with the food, space food, made out of powder and water, but they were even able to bake some cakes there. So you see they can also survive, and they developed also some music and dance on the moon. So this is how the astronaut and the preparation, and that's how the moon base look like from the drone above. So you see, they go outside, they explore the moon volcanic field, they found some lava tubes, they take some samples, and then they analyze them to understand the history of the moon. So we found some places where we would want to put some habitat. Now, how are we going to live there? Only for scientists and engineers? No, we want to bring everybody. We want to bring designer, architect, artist, journalist, Paola, and all our friends. And this is what we have started 10 years ago. We started the Moon Academy with everybody invited to discuss what could be our life on the surface of the moon. So these are some artists that we put them on the surface of the moon with our little lander. And they developed some projects. So we had every year 20 artistic students developing artwork inspired by the moon. So here is a robotic village that was built by this student, an installation with music and light. And here we also grew some organic tissues. So we printed living organism. This is with mushroom slime mold that you could have on the surface of the moon, and they survive, and they could even be used for manufacturing. And we organize also musical events in some space modules that we have at ESTEC, and that are also a precursor for what we have on the moon base. So we organize events as well in the middle of the city, the so-called Lunar Sociology Telescope, and a concept invented in Padova at the international conference by some students, where you put telescopes all over the cities to watch the moon and to inspire everybody by the moon. Here is our Lunar Sociology Telescope. We bring some landers in the middle of the city. We even had some music event where we built an agora and we play some moon music in the center of the city. Here we went at the Concertgebouw in Amsterdam for a Star Wars event, and we also brought telescopes and astronauts there. More recently, we had even a series of projects called Global Science Opera. So it's a collaboration between 20 classrooms all over the world. Each of them write a scene for an opera. And the last opera was about the moon village, the story of a little girl that is born on the moon in 2040. And what does she learn at school? And will she come back to Earth? And so that's, you have to watch the Global Science Opera with a beautiful performance, dance and music. And we have a forum with, you know, explorers, artists from all ages, as you can see, that are involved. We are also looking now to send a gallery of art and of music on the surface of the moon. And we follow some experiments that we have already flown, a tray of artifacts that we will send to the moon. So this has flown on the International Space Station, some living organisms, some samples, and now we are looking to bring this gallery of art on the surface of the moon. And I'm going to ask your contribution because it costs only 1 million euro per kilogram. And then for this reason, we are designing a miniature collection of various pieces of art. This is, for instance, horse hair, this is origami, this is beautiful artifact. This is an outer space treaty. This is an allegory of the relation between the Earth and the moon. This is a sample from air from Antarctica, the freshest air, purest air of Earth we want to send to the moon. We have also an Escher sphere or black cube. We have the moon phase. We have a monument to the intellect, various art pieces we want to send to the surface of the moon. And so this is what we are sending to the moon. And for this, we are going to prepare it. And I would like to end this by inviting you to join me in trying to get to all together to fly to the moon. So, fly to the moon and let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter, on Mars. He knows the world. Hold my hand. In all the world, darling, tease me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are what I long for, all I worship and adore. In all the world, please be true. In all the world, I love you. So see you on the moon then.
Wow.
Thank you.
Grazie Bernard. Bravissimo. Now.
As you can see, we're singers. Yes, thank you.
Yes, so we are with you in the moon. We want to thank you for being sharp for once and art and science. And also in time and in harmony with the moon rising, we are glad to give the floor to Lillian Linge, which is an artist, for being on the moon, flying again to the moon, and to have a look of moon men. Thank you, Lillian.
I'd like just to say my name is Lillian Lin, not
yes.
Lin. And moon is moon meme. And I think everybody knows what a meme is, a cultural meme, which is something that continues for a very long time and is in a sense part everybody's, belongs to everybody, a meme. So what I've said, what I've joined is moon and meme. So moon meme basically means something about the moon that is universal.
Yes.
In 1991 or 92, I conceived of moon meme. And I'm going to read this because it'll be quicker because I was told I shouldn't speak too long. So I want to share my screen with you first.
Thank you.
Okay. Which one? No, it doesn't come. Okay. I have to get rid of this.
Right. Here we go.
Here we go. Disappeared.
Thank you.
Right. So I'll share this screen with you and you can ponder it. That is Moon today, by the way. so if you go outside, you'll probably see it. It's not full, Stavros. It will be full in 2 days' time.
Right.
I conceived Moon Meme in 1992 in the continuing development of my work with language that began with Poem Machines in 1962. Most of my text works use revolution or spinning to detach words from their context and return them to their original vibrations, in other words, sound, or vibrations, which become sound to us when we hear them. The overall purpose of this project is to cause the meaning of an essential word to be transformed and renewed by the relative motions of the moon, earth, and the sun, the cosmic movements that control day, night, and the tides. This is a project that has occupied me for many years. And because of this and the inherent technical difficulties, it has evolved through numerous different approaches. Originally, I had the idea of projecting a word onto the surface of the moon. I envisaged the letters large enough so that they could be plainly seen and read by a person standing on the surface of the moon. Since the moon presents itself to us in a repeating cycle of phases, the letters composing the chosen word would only slowly emerge and then eventually disappear with the waning of the moon. The choice of the word was instantaneous. She came to mind as another epithet for moon, since the lunar cycle has, since time immemorial, been connected to the feminine principle. Working with John Brown, Astronomer Royal of Scotland, I considered using laser technology to project the letters and discovered that most of this technology was comparable to that of Star Wars. I want to say Star Wars, not the film. I also investigated the idea of earthworks. Earthworks on the moon, which led me to imagine the eventuality of these moonworks having already occurred, and how moonworks might be experienced by a viewer on Earth. I really like the idea of moonworks. So this would be the first huge moon work installation, first art installation, real art installation across the lunar surface, which may take years to make. Another imagined solution is the construction of huge composite kites, lightweight structures that would orbit the moon and cast shadows on its surface. These shadows would be seen on Earth as letters appearing across the lunar surface as the new crescent moon waxes to become a full moon. Since actual lunar projection is so challenging technically, I began to explore virtual projection. And with the assistance of a postgraduate astronomer, I developed a basic real-time website animation that tracks the movements of the moon with the word she projected onto its surface. This animation, which you can see there and is available on my website, is interactive, allowing the viewer to enter any date, both in the past and in the future, to see how Moon Meme would appear on that given date. Moon Meme, both online and if it tours, was accompanied by sound work and by quotations from various sources, Pliny, Talmud, and the Orphics, to illustrate the profound connections between the moon and the feminine, as well as human conjectures and fantasies about it throughout the ages. Now, I'll play you some of those because they're quite interesting.
The magical connection of the moon with menstruation is strong and widespread. The baleful moon dew used by the witches of Thessaly Sarah's first menstrual blood, taken during an eclipse of the moon. Pliny devotes a whole chapter of his natural history to the subject and gives a long list of the powers for good and for bad that a menstruating woman possesses. Her touch can blast vines, ivy, and rue, fade purple cloth, blacken linen in the washtub, tarnish copper, make bees desert their hives, and cause abortion in mares. But she can also rid a field of pests by walking around it naked before sunrise, calm a storm at sea by exposing her genitals, and cure boils and barrenness. In the Talmud, it is said that if a menstruating woman passes between two men, one of them will die.
One great fault of Homer, for which Plato never forgave the poet, was that he omitted any serious comment on the structure of the cosmos. With the Orphics, the wonderful flatness of the Homeric vision was lost in the ordered chasms that once again opened up between one heaven and the next. Hades was winkled out from his moldy underworld to be catapulted up into the atmosphere and settled in the cone of shadow between Earth and Moon, as if the lining of the planet had been turned inside out and shaken skyward, dispatching the multitude of souls it housed into a turbulent dark. Such was the immense, wind-blown waiting room of the dead. What more is said about this cone? On climbing down into Trophonius's cave, where Kore had let loose the waters of the underworld, Timarchus, a young disciple of Socrates, had imagined he was going towards Hades. But now he realized that Hades had been turned inside out into the sky, become the shadowy cone between the moon and the earth was nothing more than the continuation of Hades into the abyss. But then, why should the two worlds be so different from each other after all, given that both were places of exile? As the spirit of Timarchus thus reflected, he saw the place near the moon where the cone of shadow narrowed to a point, and saw that it was here that the drifting souls were gathering. They were trying to land on that woman's face, the moon, despite the fact that it grew more and more terrifying the nearer they got. The face seemed to be made up with an extremely fine powder, which the dead recognized as the substance of other souls. The moment they tried to grab hold of some wrinkle on the lunar surface, blinded by the white light, many would find themselves dragged by an irresistible undertow until they were falling through space again. Yet it was there that salvation lay, and they had come so close. Had they managed to set foot on this outpost of Persephone, they would one day have undergone a second death, more gradual and more delicate than the first. One day, Persephone would have separated their minds from their souls, the way Apollo could prize the armor from a warrior's shoulders. Then when...
Oh, it's cut off. Sorry, it seems to have ended. I just think it's really interesting to hear the imaginative sort of wanderings, the way people thought of the moon such a long time ago. Just so it kind of enriches the whole experience of our experience, which is so much closer and so much more somehow investigative of the moon and exploitative as well, I might add. So that is really my talk. Thank you.
The magical connection of the moon with menstruation is strong and wide.
Yeah. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Lillian.
Magical.
I stop share.
Thank you so much, Lillian.
Thank you.
So, as we said, we are inspired and enlightened by your moon beautiful presentation. May I also remind that you are exposing now in Milan for art.
The exhibition is over.
Ah, voilà, pardon. I need to update.
Unfortunately, the exhibition has ended. I was exhibiting in Milan.
You were. So if you agree, we said that we are saving time for the dialogue with the public, with the audience. And also this is the idea of having a kind of educational encouragement through the moon, through the sound. So I would, if everybody agree, we can give the floor to Alessandro Tosi. He's there. Alessandro, oh, voilà. Alessandro Tosi is the scientific director of the Museum of Graphic Art, Lanfranchi Palace in Pisa. And this beautiful exhibition, The Rhythm of the Space, he will tell us. Thank you, Alessandro.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all of you and to Stavros, of course, to have organized this beautiful meeting. So I show you some images. Yes, you see?
Yes, we can see.
Yes.
The beautiful palace, Palazzo Lanfranchi. Yes.
Because exactly 1 year ago, just in autumn, the exhibition The Rhythm of Space, curated by Stavros Katsanevas, was visible at the Museo della Grafica, Museum of Graphic Arts, in Palazzo Lanfranchi in Pisa. This is the image of the palace and exhibition. An exhibition that was an exciting container of ideas, suggestions, emotions. At the entrance, in an amphitheater set up in the first room, Stavros explained in a great blackboard the aim of the exhibition. You can see. The discovery of the gravitational waves, he wrote, and I quote, added a space-time vibrations, the rhythm or sound of space to the millenary apprehensions of the universe as a sublime but silent visual image. Studying images, for example, in the Galilean age, I am fascinated by this. What kind of images of the universe will we have? Or better, after the discovery of the gravitational waves, how art and science can offer new models of representation? And what could it mean exactly? It's a new acoustic, not silent, visual image. In that occasion, artists gave many answers through their works, from Bertrand Lamarche to Laetitia Rouse de Maigret, Gorka Alda, Anton Ortiz, Rafael de la Porta, Thomas Saraceno, Pavel Bruckner, Pavel Buchler, Raymond Gall, Attila Sorgo, Vincenzo Napolano too, Joel Thompson, and of course, Lillian Lin. Installations, videos, sculptures, in which the sound and the voice of the universe add a narrative and visual dimension. The location of the exhibition in a museum that preserves a rich and important collection of prints and drawings was really significant. As many of the installations, videos or sculpture were drawings themselves, suggesting the same grammar of science and lines, the same visual code. Sarah, for example, Saraceno's work, How to Entangle the Universe in a Spider Web, is an astonishing drawing full of science, lines, graphic plots, and lattices. Also, the cosmic levitation that we have seen, thanks to Stavros, is not only a representation of planets, but seems to trace a musical score in the space. Lillian's gravity dance is an elegant line traced with a silver point on a sheet. Really a beautiful work. Thank you very much, Lillian, for this. And Moon Mem, that we have seen now, is a so delicate, poetic, graphic thought in relation to the sound and the voice. So, the drawing and the voice. I remember a short, wonderful text by Yves Bonnefoy, Le Dessin et la Voix, written in 2005, in which the poet talked about our need to connect the drawing to the voice, not only to the hand. The idea to link the act to draw to the voice, and in this way to enlarge the narrative possibilities of science and life is really fascinating. Furthermore, Bonnefoy proposed as an example, a suggestive example, a masterpiece by Adam Elsheimer, The Mocking of Ceres, painted by the German master at the beginning of the 27th century. We can add, as you know, another masterpiece by Elsheimer, that was the author of the first image of an astronomical Galilean sky in his flight to Egypt with a milk way and the moon, just to come back to the moon meme by Lilians. Because now, in a dialogue with science artists, now in dialogue with science, artists can offer images that become drawings, that become sound. And the sound, this is the last image of the exhibition, and I thanks also Etsy Kuska for this beautiful image that is also the cover of the catalog of the exhibition. And this sound means voices and stories to compose a poetry of the universe that is able to give us, through the interaction between science and art, science and artist, new, intense, deeper emotions. Thank you.
Grazie Alessandro, thank you. Alessandro, and now?
I try to wait.
Thank you so much. May I say just one word? Thank you for this beautiful presentation. We want now to open the dialogue. If we agree with all the participants, we had 175. Now we have 121 to open up the dialogue. And also I take the opportunity, because we had some musical contribution from Saturn via Yves Langevin, then directly from Bernard Foix, but also other musicians are with us, the maestro Vangelis, which is now working for NASA, composing with the sound of Juno, and the astrophysicist and guitarist of Queen, Brian May, that I hope in future to be with us, Jean-Michel Jarre, as well as a young composer as Jean Grunewald, who already was with us for Sputnik and from the Open Forum, From Leonardo to the Moon. So we also have the hello of Lucy Hawking, and we all hope now to open the discussion if we all agree. So I would say, let's listen if we have some direct question. Otherwise, my question would be, the universe and the planet are talking to us. So we are listening to the voice of the universe and of the planet. And what kind of message do you think that they are sending to us? Thank you.
Okay, in one sense, the universe and the planet, they are talking to us also from inside, because we are built, you know, of atoms which were produced in the universe. So we have the outside sound, the signal we can hear, but we have also some message inside our bodies. The water that we contain, hydrogen was formed at the Big Bang, the oxygen was formed in the center of stars. So we have also to listen into the song of the universe that is inside our own body.
Yes, thank you. I also may take the opportunity that thanks, Wanda.
Let me ask, Lillian.
I just wanted to say something. Wanda, I thought I was very moved by Wanda's talk. And, you know, 5,000 years ago in Sumer, people did not use their eyes, I mean, in this, the way we do. So knowledge was acquired completely by ear. It was totally oral, an oral culture. So I think it's a kind of interesting thing. We have been for a very long time a visual culture. So long that we don't even have a noun for hearing. Think of that in English. There's no noun for hearing. There are, in other languages there are, but language is interesting. It talks about the way we think, and since English in a way has predominated for you know, for quite a long time. It means something when there's no noun for hearing. It means that the culture does not listen. And we do need to, I agree, Bernard, we need to listen more and more. It is so important, you know. That's what I wanted to say.
Paola, so mention one thing the planets can tell us is also something about also our planet. Because if you look at the range of conditions on neighbor planets, Venus is probably the best model for what could happen on Earth if you have a runaway greenhouse effect with all the CO2 going out in the atmosphere and the temperature reaching 500. Mars is the reverse.
Yes.
The water went away, it's completely cold and dry. So comparative planetology means the planets can also tell us something about what happens on the Earth.
Yes, and probably the Mother Earth is also telling us something, no? With the climate changes, we cannot go on like this. So we have also an educational responsibility, being science, our common heritage. So
I want to take the speech because we had a question by Liliana Longobardi. Was Dante a visionary when he spoke of circulated melody, harmony of the spheres of an ordered universe as a musical system, which is, as you all know, something very close to my heart about that. And I wanted to say something I wanted to say in the beginning about it, and also say something of the very important thing that Eve just said, but I start with this question. A French philosopher that influenced me a lot in my life was Michel Serre. And he says the following thing, that humanity spent in the beginning a lot of time projecting the earth things to the sky. You have the zodiac, the famous zodiac. What is the zodiac? It's earth adventures, someone going with the wife of the other, or things like that, projected in the sky. And it is also a world where, let's say, the mythical and the reality of the world are mixed. They are not very well separated. And it's not worse. When we call mythical today, it is how we see it today. Then it was much more intelligent, much more integrated. Then came these two efforts that you all said. One is Thales goes to the pyramids and he uses light and shadow and invents geometry. And you have Pythagoras, who invents through rhythm, tries to understand, he sees, of course, these repetitions, and through the repetition and the rhythm, tries to understand the universe as a musical. The musical harmony starts from that. And humanity takes up the rhythmic pattern till the time of Galileo. It's more rhythmic, even the Ptolemaic system, you can call it a sort of this. It's a rhythmic system. And Galileo comes and invents the new society, the new world, with Descartes and Newton afterwards, that makes the universe more geometric, trajectory and not rhythm. And that's a very interesting thing. It permitted us to be where we are. Nobody should snob that part. And there we come in the third region, that the third time, which is what I said after the World War, where we used, for instance, we had both atomic bombs, and at the same time we had radio. We discovered radio, and we used radio to understand the sky, and then we went up to space, and with space we saw X-rays, etc. And we entered in this new thing that, again, the rhythm and the vibrations, the multi-messenger, we said, we increase again, although Wanda was complaining and she was right, that we left a few of the things aside, we are entering again into a new image of the universe. And we are really, are expecting that to happen. And that's what we think we are celebrating here. And the second thing I wanted to say, sorry I talked too much, the second thing I wanted to say is exactly what Eve said, But for instance, in Virgo, in order to be able to understand the universe, you have to understand very well all the sounds and all the vibration of the earth, of the clouds, the electromagnetic noises, the anthropogenic noises, the people that come with their car. You know that because of the pandemic, the natural vibrations of Earth were diminished by 30%. So what we say is, in order to listen to the cosmos as a universe, you first have to understand the cosmos here as Earth and as society and as human beings. These are the four themes that we also pushed in this exhibition, that the four cosmos, they were called cosmos in antique Greece, all of them were called as good orders. These good orders have to be mixed somehow to understand and mix them again. And sorry for talking too much, but I think I wanted to ask too.
Thank you, Stavro, for the beautiful explanation. We know that you are a maestro in the field. And thank you to Liliana Longo to raise her question. Actually, next year we will celebrate the 700th year of Dante, and we hope to have the possibility to come back in the reality. Then there is also a question from Fabio that might be addressed to Eve, which is our planetologist today. He would like to know, is the question is in Italian, Ivo, Eve. Sorry for italianizing your name. Dice, buonasera, good evening. I would like to know what planet we were able to listen and to have a radio frequencies in audio. And there are other astronomical listening of this kind of, let's say, give type and this. Thank you. What do you think, Eve?
Okay, so basically you have equivalence for quite a few places. You have heard the sound from Saturn, there is something similar for Jupiter. There is also something very similar for the Earth, which is called Chorus, and also the Whistler, which was also mentioned during the presentation, which was the starting point for this use of sound. So basically, we hope to have also some nice sounds from radio from Mercury. That will be from BepiColombo, the mission which is underway. Also from Juice on Jupiter. So again, the music will be different. Mercury will be much more shrill because it's so small that all frequencies are higher. But if you go to the site of space agencies or you go to Google, you can find quite a few examples of music from planets in the radio regime. This is a very classical approach to making clear what kind of frequencies are around these planets. So just go to Google, you will find a lot.
Yes, may I also add that even the European Space Agency produced the sound from space on the website, and that is a very good tool for educational purpose. So we did last year at La Sorbonne from Leonardo to the moon, and we hope to be able to do with the Stavros approval and cooperation next year from the moon to Leonardo and to Will, to Ego. So if there are other questions, it would be a good moment for answer. Otherwise, I have other questions.
Voilà. May I add to the very good comment of Ives in your comment that also the Radio Jove project has planetary emissions from Jupiter that also people can acquire real time from home. The planetary emissions, the long bursts and the short bursts are there, and you can also acquire it real time. I apologize.
No, you did a wonderful presentation, Wanda. And I also may take the opportunity to thank all the team that cooperate to the success. Of course, the bright speakers that invest time and energy to be with us, but as well the European Gravitational Observatory outreach team and the community that work so well, but as well Marika Branchesi that announced our talk, and from the G. Leonardo, Silvia Rosa Brusin, and many other friends that are with us that are cooperating. So we hope that we will be able to be together springtime and to contribute to some new educational tools. So talking about the future and talking about the lack of basic scientific education, what do you think, how we can improve that? This is the main problem. It seems like that only 5 to 10% of the world population is highly educated in the world. So that's the reason why we adopt the Sustainable Development Goal number 4, inclusive quality education. So what is your idea? How can we fascinate more and to offer role models and good models for kids and girls, encouraging them to study scientific discipline?
If I can take again, the sorry for talking too much, but since we're also arriving at the end and we have a very nice thing coming up at 6 o'clock, Surfing Einstein, I would like to say a few words to probably when we make the site where we'll put all the slides so that people can have, we will try to put the site, it is the Ego site, we will put all this in the Ego site and we inform you. But we will also put an essay that I liked a lot, which was done by two very important persons in physics. One is Kip Thorne, this the Nobel Prize of gravitational waves, and also he was helped for Interstellar. He's well known also for that. And Roger Blanford, an astrophysicist that has done a lot of things that were said by everybody on the jets and things like that, about how will it be the education and science after the pandemic. And they said a very nice thing. They said, as after Sputnik, somehow also in the spirit of the Cold War, there was a renaissance of a lot of science and education. Probably after the pandemic, we have to understand new connections between research and scientists and educators. And somehow we were together, we were all, now the, for instance, the educators, the professors were at the center because they had to teach children in pandemic situation. So, and there you have a lot of enthusiastic people there, somehow sometimes isolated scientists doing their research, somehow they are so absorbed, they don't make enough connections and things like that. So there is a rethinking, a new synthesis between education and science that has to be done. And in what concerns, again, sorry for finishing with our publicity, we have European programs. One is called Rainforce. And this, we try to give data from the gravitational wave antenna, that is Beagle, to the citizens so they can analyze them exactly as we did today, both through visual and sound, and participate of characterizing the noise and eventually finding a supernova. So things like that, we will try in Virgo and Ego to push a lot. We have good connections also. You introduced her to us, Isabella Marini, who is a very important person in the digital science in Italy. And we'll try to have connections with the schools and the professors. Through the professors, we will not go directly because it's not our task, but essentially try to interact a lot with the schools, teachers, high school teachers to do things. So yes, please.
I would like to follow up on the renaissance, because I think that exact word that we need now, we are in a crisis situation, and now we have to have a renaissance. Renaissance where we connect art and science, like Leonardo was doing. And now we have also a Renaissance because we are going to leave partly this planet. We left it with robots, but we have a new continent to explore. So there is a key moment where we have to use all resources. So science, technology, engineering, but also art. And also I believe that the same way everybody should be taught mathematics and physics, they should be taught music.
Sure. One thing, sorry, we received a beautiful question from a 12 years girl. Her name is Anita, and she would like to know, so the future is talking to us. Grazie Anita per la tua domanda. Anita, in seconda media, she would like so much, what is our study career? We are all different, Anita, siamo tutti differenti, but I would propose to give the floor to Yves, because his family, as we said, is a wonderful planetologist, but his family, being also part of the Curie family, nice story to tell. He will tell us, probably, hopefully, and he has a 6 Nobel laureate in his family. So maybe Eve can tell the story in education of the family, how the Curie, they were so critical against the French education. Grazie. Per spiegare Anita il percorso di...
Yeah, okay. Of course, my case was a bit different from other kids, because the discussion at lunch was about Einstein and the physics and nuclear physics and also the atomic bomb. At that time, it was very much in progress. So indeed, I had a kind of advanced knowledge of a lot of things because it was discussed at lunch, at dinner, every time. And as usual, when you are in a doctor family, you end up being a doctor. So I ended up in science because it was something which was all wrong. As most kids, I also wanted to do something else. So my parents and my grandparents and my great-grandparents were nuclear physics. So I decided to go to astrophysics and planetary science. My uncle actually went to biology. So, but still, I mean, it's clear that my field at that time, the main reason I went to science and planetary science in particular was that I was 18 years old when I looked on TV at the Armstrong walking on the moon. And when you are 18, it was a very strong motivation to be interested in that kind of topic, as you can understand. So that kind of fields, by the way, is very attractive to young people. I don't know whether Anita is interested, but when we talk to young people in colleges, in high schools, about exploring the planets, exploring the universe. Today, it's a bit like what you had last century or the 19th century, people coming back from Africa and looking at completely new territories, at least for white men, not for black men, which were living there for hundreds of years. So planetary exploration is something which can motivate young people. That's something I keep telling people. So for me, clearly, Apollo was a very clear clincher to go into that field. I don't know whether that answers completely your question, but again, I am a bit specific. I'm afraid I cannot serve as a template for everybody because I knew basically a lot about the science community even before entering it.
Grazie, Yves. Altre risposte per Anita? Qual è il vostro percorso di studi? Wanda, per esempio, una donna che risponde a una ragazza. Wanda, would you answer what is your...
Wanda excused herself. She was a little bit weak. She's on a different time scale, so she's not she's not with us.
She d'accordo. Left. D'accordo. So I just want to tell Anita in Italian, if we want, or in English, that, for example, Marie Curie and her husband, Pierre Curie, they were very critical, may I say, in front of the French educational system. So they decided with the other family to educate directly their kids. And then Eva can correct me, of course, because it's a family heritage story. So they grow up two little girls, and one is Irène Joliot, the grandmother of Yves, and his grandfather. They got the Nobel Prize for chemistry. And the other daughter, Eva, she got the Nobel Prize for peace. So let's say it's a good story, like, no, education is so important. Education can change lives. Probably if they would have entered into the normal French school, they would not get the Nobel, maybe. Voilà. Another special case is Bernard.
I think things have improved. The good news for Anita is that you don't need to be born in a Nobel Prize family, fortunately. Yeah. Otherwise, and, it would be
and there are brilliant minds all over the continents. Huh? I see that was also what we have to reach. In developing countries, we have a lot of brilliant minds. And these are those that we need also to engage with us and to work also in their local neighborhood.
Yes, thank you. I don't know if there are other questions from, we know that we have to give the floor, it's a kind of a conclusion. They ask us if we know the music printed on the Church of Naples of Gesù Nuovo. I don't know if we know, I don't know personally, but...
Maradona, maybe?
We don't know, but what I would like to say, if you all agree, that stay with us, because there will be other beautiful presentation with Margherita Cappelletto, with the astronomical community, and yes, Liliane also is thanking everyone. Maybe Liliane would like to tell us what is her studies itinerary. Liliane would like
studies
to Anita.
Are you speaking to me?
Yes, Anita, little girl, 12 years.
What studies?
Yes, please.
What do you? I mean, I don't know what you mean by that question.
What are your studies that you did allowing you to give this beautiful masterpiece that you sign usually?
Well, I mean, I actually, I studied archaeology.
Ah.
Yeah. And at the Sorbonne and the École du Louvre. And then I became an artist instead of an archaeologist. And so, you know, there are just many roads to these professions, I think. I became an artist. I always wanted to be an artist. Science attracted me actually very young. When I was about 19, I started reading books on optics. And then trying to understand physics. I had so little maths and physics I was taught so badly, so terribly badly, that I didn't find it at all interesting at the time. But then I started finding it interesting myself, because I wanted to find out what reality was. That was the question I asked. What is reality? That's what led me to looking at physics. You could think that it might be an alien area for an artist, but actually not. Many artists have been interested in science. In all kinds of science. I mean, science is huge. There's so many subjects, topics of interest. So I was interested in physics and astronomy, but there's lots of other things. It's basically just understanding who one is, just trying to understand, while one passes through this very, very brief existence. Thank you.
Thank you, Lillian. You are number one. Then what we want to say is that, Anita, for us, then the floor will be given to Stavros, the science approach and discipline, it represents the future. Così dovresti studiare una disciplina scientifica, especially now for critical thinking. We need to have new scientist generation in Europe, also for understanding all this sound from the universe, from the planet, from the Earth Mother. And if you all agree, in 1 minute, if you want to say one word for future, Stavros can conclude.
I think it will take us too much, and over 10 minutes. You made a terrific job to put us in order, and we finished at 6 o'clock. Let's keep it like that. We are only 10 minutes late. So I would not add much. I would say I was, you know, although we organized it, I was moved by the way we all were, and the questions and the interactions. And I think that's very nice. And that's what you just said, critical thinking and collective thinking and not herd thinking, not the one from the other. And that's, I hope we showed, then we will win. And that's, and I really would like to thank all the fantastic people we had with us today. And then we have not finished, because we have a teaser. I have to say that we have with us Margherita Cappelletto, Merit Xell. Margherita had to leave because they both came to Virgo and Ego, and they did another thing that we did not do here. We talked about sound, we talked about light. They made us move, they made us dance. So they said, again, this is, you know, the touch, the movements. Also, movement is something that has to be understood. It is inside the complex, both of art and science. And so they are preparing a very nice film called Surfing Einstein, which will, it has not yet come in, but we will show a few things about it. I mean, they will show a small trailer, if you wish, a teaser about it. And I think it's very important. And then we'll go to see the actual moon through the group of astrophili of Kashina and our friend Antonacci. And that would be the climax, if you wish, the end of this bright night. So let's move. It's Valerio, it's you that we will show it.
Ok, sì, per questa seconda parte switchiamo in italiano.
In italiano, sì.
E questa seconda parte, diciamo, è diciamo una sorta di esperienza un po' anche per rilassarsi da diciamo dopo questa lunga, diciamo, discussione. E divisa in due parti, quindi una parte dedicata sempre al rapporto in qualche modo tra arte e scienza con la danza, e un'altra parte dedicata invece a delle osservazioni astronomiche della Luna che effettuerà Domenico Antonacci, che è il presidente degli astrofili di Kashina. Sapete bene che appunto le onde gravitazionali sono in qualche modo la colonna sonora dei fenomeni astrofisici, e quindi dove c'è la musica spesso c'è anche la danza, e in particolare appunto due persone appunto hanno avuto due esperte di danza, e in particolare una persona anche ricercatrice hanno avuto l'idea di coniugare questi due aspetti, quindi danza e onde gravitazionali. E quindi ho il piacere di presentarvi Margherita Cappelletto, che è ricercatrice del CNR, laureata in astrofisica, e appunto ha eseguito anche diverse performance in passato, e l'altra è la coreografa Merixel Campos-Olivier, nota a livello internazionale. E entrambe queste due esperte di danza e anche di scienza hanno girato essenzialmente due film, uno all'Università di Roma, La Sapienza, l'altro qui proprio a Virgo sul sito, usando appunto i fisici come ballerini, quindi delle persone che teoricamente non sono degli esperti di danza, ben lungi da esserlo, diciamo in qualche modo, no, dei ballerini specializzati, ma in qualche modo nelle loro mani, in qualche modo sotto la loro guida lo sono diventati, e questa performance è diventata alla fine due film, e ne vedremo uno dei due, diciamo, a breve. Quindi lascio a Margherita e Merixel la parola.
Grazie mille Valerio, grazie Stavros, ringraziamo Ego, Virgo e gli organizzatori di Bright Night 2020 per averci invitato, per aver invitato Surfing Einstein in questa bellissima serata. Surfing Einstein è un documentario artistico la cui storia comincia probabilmente nel 2017. Io, come hai ben detto, sono laureata in astrofisica, sono un'appassionata, ma soltanto come spettatrice, di danza contemporanea, e stavo indagando delle possibilità di dialogo tra questi due mondi, sia con un fine più educativo che a livello artistico. Quando ho incontrato Merixel, un'amica comune me l'ha presentata, Merixel, una coreografa e regista spagnola che vive a Berlino ma fa spesso capolino in Italia e a Roma. E ci incontriamo, le racconto delle onde gravitazionali, dell'incredibile storia dietro la loro scoperta, lei ascolta, assorbe. E mi dice queste parole che io non dimentico. Dice: Margherita, lavoro spesso, ho lavorato tanto con i progetti di community dance, sarebbero quei progetti appunto dove si lavora con persone che non sono danzatori professionisti. Adesso forse vorrei concentrarmi più su un'opera per il teatro. Poi i fisici ci hanno aperto le porte di uno spazio-tempo molto personale, e perturbazioni comprese, direi. E a questo punto io darei la parola alle immagini.
gradually we became aware of a hum in the room. An electrical hum in the
thank you.
Grazie Valerio, spero vi sia piaciuto nonostante la fruizione non ottimale alla quale ci condanna la pandemia, speriamo ancora per poco, ci auguriamo che questa storia che al momento del teaser aveva fatto alcuni passi, ma successivamente abbiamo aggiunto altri capitoli. Non posso non ricordare le intense giornate di lavoro collettivo a Virgo del 2019. Speriamo di poter tornare con una vera e propria premiere del film di persona. Prima di lasciare la parola alla fautrice di questa incursione della danza nel mondo delle onde gravitazionali, volevo cogliere l'occasione per ringraziare tutti i danzatori, mi piace chiamarli così perché è quello che ci hanno regalato la loro danza e tutta, non li posso citare uno ad uno perché sono tantissimi, e tutta la squadra perché appunto senza la produzione di Dieter Meier, senza Marcus, Danila, Serena sicuramente non saremmo qui. Marichelle, prego.
Sì, buonasera a tutti e anche scusatemi il mio italiano che è un po' tra spagnolo e tra una invenzione. Ma se avete qualcuna domanda o qualcun dubbio, non mi spiego bene, allora mi domandate. E sì, anche io vorrei ringraziare a tutte le persone che hanno partecipato, che ci hanno aiutato in qualche modo, sia i protagonisti, sia la parte della produzione, la parte tecnica, e anche per la bella esperienza. Io, come Margherita Capelletto ha detto adesso, sono andata in Sapienza al G23, portata della mano di Margherita, con il pensiero di fare un teatro danza sulle onde gravitazionali. Per me è importante spiegare come è avvenuto che ho cambiato il pensiero o l'idea di cambiare un po' il mestiere e andare più per il cinema. E soprattutto in questa ricerca che ho iniziato per entrare un po' nel mondo della fisica, concretamente delle onde gravitazionali, e ovviamente ho preso contatto con i gruppi di fisici della Sapienza e piano piano mi ho rendita conto che è loro come persone tra queste onde, tra la fisica, e sono un bel esempio di lavoro in gruppo, di anche una solidarietà nella maniera di vedere un progetto e anche la perseveranza. Mi hanno sembrato aspetti che soprattutto nel mondo che abitiamo oggi può essere molto necessario parlarne. Allora la idea ha tornato così, diciamo che i protagonisti sono le persone dietro la fisica con tutte le sue caratteristiche, emozioni, paure, desideri, allegria, tutto insieme, e posso dire che forse la fisica viene rappresentata di maniera indiretta, perché le persone che la rappresentano sono i veri protagonisti. Sì, e anche è stata una sensazione molto intensa al momento dove loro hanno sviluppato il suo linguaggio corporale, perché devo dire veramente che sì, nonostante io ho fatto un po' di guida e loro hanno dato al 100% della sua energia, il suo tempo, la sua concentrazione, e sono molto stupita di il risultato e di vedere il suo movimento, di vedere la sua espressione corporale. solamente questo momento per me già ha valuto la pena fare questo progetto. Allora, se qualcuno ha una domanda o voi volete parlare con qualcuno dei protagonisti, mi sa, Margherita, che abbiamo alcune dei nostri protagonisti, non è vero?
Sì, qualcuno collegato, lo riconosco dai nomi, e se tra i partecipanti c'è qualche curiosità, senz'altro loro potrebbero anche condividere anche via chat qualcuna delle loro impressioni. Io sono anche un po' forse dall'esterno, sono rimasta molto stupita da come è avvenuto questo dialogo, dalla concentrazione che tutti quanti hanno messo e forse anche da questa assenza di paura di affrontare questa sfida, che si vede anche davanti alla telecamera, secondo me. Però se c'è qualcuno che vuole commentare o qualche domanda, se no...
Io volevo solo fare un commento, io non ho partecipato a questo primo video, ma al secondo che avete fatto qui sul sito, e devo dire che è assolutamente impressionante la capacità che c'ha Merrick Sell di coordinare tutte le varie persone, perché lì eravamo veramente tantissimi ballerini, ballerini, tantissimi fisici, e veramente poi alla fine il senso globale del lavoro era veramente, veramente notevole, perché è una sorta di metafora in qualche modo della propagazione del segnale gravitazionale all'interno dell'interferometro, trasformato poi in uno spettacolo di danza con tutte le persone che poi alla fine non erano effettivamente esperte, ma che lo sono diventate grazie a Merrick Sell. Insomma, quindi è una vera, insomma, una sorta di vera e propria opera d'arte alla fine, quella che è venuta fuori.
Una domanda da parte di Adele, che saluto. Quanto è stato complesso interagire con i fisici, Merrick Sell?
No, niente di complessi. Pensate che io lavoro con artisti, con attori, attrici, ballerini, ballerina. Allora, è stato veramente anche molto, come si chiama, molto facile comunque. Io ogni tanto... aveva la sensazione di essere un po', non so se si dice in italiano, pesata, no? O come si dice in italiano, sempre insistendo, bussando alla porta dell'ufficio di qualcuno, al G23, posso fare una domanda, possiamo fare questo, possiamo fare... ma devo dire che loro in Sapienza e anche tutti i fisici di Virgo hanno risposto in una maniera molto generosa e anche con molta passione per il progetto. E sì, vorrei ripetere questo, che senza la sua cooperazione e collaborazione non avreste potuto possibile farlo. Allora, Valerio, non è solamente io, che anche siete voi.
Ok. Grazie, quindi non vediamo l'ora di vedere poi il prodotto finito, insomma, del film girato qui a Virgo con tutte le persone della collaborazione, i fisici della collaborazione. Se, non lo so, se volete aggiungere qualcos'altro, se no,
ditemi. Sì, solamente vorrei aggiungere solamente una cosa. Noi non vediamo l'ora di presentare il film con... è stato un po' una pena che dopo di averlo girato ha iniziato il periodo di corona e così un po' il mio sogno di mostrare il film con tutto il pubblico in presente e non mostrare il film per prima volta online per questo noi aspettiamo ancora un pochino con la speranza che presto lo potremo fare senza corona o non so come, ma preferirei tanto mostrare il film con voi insieme nello stesso posto e non vederlo così da lontano online. Allora incrociamo la dita che lo possiamo fare molto presto.
Anche grazie, Mejel. Un'ultima risposta alla domanda di Liliana.
Ha proiettato, sì.
Per continuare questo dialogo tra i mondi, anche nella appunto fase di proiezione, noi pensiamo che non solo i mondi delle persone che li fanno, ma tutti i circuiti che fanno andare avanti queste macchine, sia bene che il film arrivi a entrambi i circuiti, quindi i circuiti più artistici e i circuiti più legati al mondo della scienza. E questa è un po' la risposta.
Sì, e anche un dettaglio importante che non vorrei dimenticare, che soprattutto a Virgo non solamente hanno partecipato i fisici, sino anche il personale che lavora a Virgo, sia dalla polizia o lavorando in caffetteria. Allora questo mi sembra un dettaglio molto speciale, perché anche senza loro non è possibile che le cose vanno avanti. Allora sono anche una parte molto importante.
Okay. Okay. No, cioè, ci hanno chiesto dove sarà proiettato, cioè una delle possibili idee era qui, quando sarà possibile, forse addirittura qui sul sito, insomma.
Sì, sarebbe fantastico. Virgo è come la casa di Surfing Einstein, allora sarebbe un piacere mostrarlo a Virgo, assolutamente.
Va bene. Allora, vi ringrazio.
Io voglio aggiungere il nostro piacere, veramente lo aspettiamo, perché è fantastico anche queste cose che abbiamo visto. Abbiamo visto la metà già con la parte di Roma, ma è sempre straordinario di vederlo e rivederlo. Dunque aspettiamo questa proiezione veramente con... Avevamo l'idea in primo di fare qualcosa al Museo della Grafica, ma no, aspettiamo, come dici, aspettiamo la fine di questa pandemia e facciamo qualcosa di...
Sì, per poterci dare un abbraccio prima e dopo il film. Mi sa che vale la pena aspettare anche per questo.
Sì, sì.
C'è una domanda carina nella chat che chiede appunto se Ettore Majorana è un omonimo, e in realtà è il nipote dell'Ettore Majorana famoso nella storia della fisica, quindi è effettivamente parente del Majorana famoso, e tra l'altro è impressionante perché gli assomiglia anche fisicamente, quindi se voi confrontate, avete visto nel film, lo vedete una foto dell'altro Majorana, assomiglia anche tra l'altro.
Passiamo a Domenico, che vedere la luna.
Certo, ora direi appunto possiamo a questo punto passare al saluto.
Grazie intanto, ancora.
Ringrazio.
Grazie
a tutti.
E, a questo punto questa seconda parte appunto è l'abbiamo pensata insieme a Domenico Antonacci, che è il presidente delle Astrofili di Cascina, e l'idea era quella di fare delle osservazioni astronomiche in diretta con un strumento a sua disposizione della superficie lunare, e quindi un'esplorazione della superficie lunare. Ora non sono sicuro se le condizioni atmosferiche lo consentono, ora sentiamo Domenico cosa ci dice.
No, purtroppo al momento c'è il cielo nuvoloso, okay. Io però dietro di me ho qui il telescopio che è pronto, io parlerò un po' della Luna e spero che magari si riesca a liberare un attimino dalle nuvole e farvi vedere anche qualche immagine in diretta.
Va bene.
Ok, quindi vai, procedo, vai. Apro un attimino il file della...
Sì. Ci condividerà appunto una sua presentazione, Domenico.
Sì, perché ho preparato la presentazione in attesa di vedere magari far capolino alla Luna. Se poi vedo che arriva la Luna, mi interrompo un attimo e... Ok. Penso che vedete la presentazione. E voglio prima di tutto ringraziare Casnevas, il direttore di Diego Virgo, per l'invito, per la partecipazione dell'Associazione Cascinesi Astrofili, e Valerio e tutto lo staff di Virgo, con cui collaboriamo sempre con molto piacere. Noi siamo gli astrofili, quindi siamo appassionati, non siamo professionisti, e cerchiamo di fare queste cose dando e trasmettendo in emozioni in diretta, facendo possibilmente le osservazioni in diretta. Siamo molto bravi a beccare le serate di nuvolo quando programmiamo le osservazioni astronomiche, però questo fa parte del nostro destino, amaro destino. E stasera appunto la Luna la vediamo, se riusciamo un po' a far capolino, vediamo se si libera, e il nostro satellite naturale, il satellite che ci segue nel nostro percorso intorno al Sole. Questa è un'immagine fatta a suo tempo dalla sonda Voyager, quando ha fatto un selfie praticamente a Terra-Luna, e quindi è un oggetto che, naturale, che gira intorno alla Terra e con noi intorno al Sole. È molto più piccola della Terra, ha un diametro di circa 3500, poco meno di 3500 metri, mostra a noi sempre la stessa faccia perché si muove con un moto sincrono, cioè lo stesso tempo che impiega a fare una rotazione su se stessa lo impiega a fare una rotazione intorno alla Terra. E questo permette a noi da Terra di vedere soltanto un lato, una faccia della Luna. A seconda di come si presenta poi nel cielo, in posizione rispetto a Terra e Sole, noi possiamo vederla piena o possiamo vederne le varie fasi, dal primo quarto a luna piena, ultimo quarto, come praticamente in questa cosa si sta andando verso la luna piena stasera, e poi verso la luna nuova, quando è dalla parte opposta, vediamo. Quindi si presenta come una falce o come una sfera completamente illuminata, o in certe notti è completamente assente. Queste sono foto scattate dalle sonde moderne, questa è la JAXA, che ci fa vedere alcune parti della superficie lunare. La superficie lunare è sugna da altopiani e da moltissimi crateri che si sono prodotti nel tempo dovuti a asteroidi, meteoriti o anche in qualche caso probabilmente di qualche cometa. Questi crateri sono lì da ormai tanti anni, e alcuni di questi sono più giovani, come vedete questi con il bordo più liscio, più rifinito, più tagliente. Alcuni con il bordo frastagliato sono molto più anziani, molto più antichi. E tutto questo è dovuto non tanto a corrosioni dovute alla pioggia, perché non c'è atmosfera sulla Luna, ma è dovuto sostanzialmente allo shock termico tra quando la Luna, le parti della Luna sono esposte al Sole e quando sono invece all'ombra. Ci sono circa 300 gradi di differenza di temperatura. Dalla forma di questi crateri noi possiamo capire se sono crateri da impatto di grossi meteoriti oppure crateri più piccoli, che erano oggetti con masse più piccole. Lo capiamo da questa montagnina che si presenta qui al centro del cratere. Per la superficie, nel momento dell'impatto, l'energia fusa completamente questa superficie, ha fatto rimbalzare il materiale verso l'alto. E poi
Paolo va un po' a scatti, forse converrebbe che tu spengessi un attimo la webcam e così riduci un attimo il traffico di banda.
Vediamo se riesco.
Webcam, cioè mantenendo scerato lo schermo e così.
Stop video, proviamo così.
Esatto, prova, vai.
Vediamo se va meglio. A seconda della posizione, dicevo, della Luna rispetto alla Terra e al Sole, noi possiamo non solo vedere le fasi della Luna, ma vedere anche dei fenomeni, con molta più rarità, che noi chiamiamo solitamente eclissi di Sole ed eclissi di Luna. Eclissi di Sole è quando la Luna si frappone tra la Terra e il Sole, proprio in questo caso del Sole, noi vediamo il Sole nero parzialmente coperto nell'eclissi parziale di Sole, eclissi anulare. Poi abbiamo, se siamo nella parte penombra del cono, siamo in eclissi totale, se siamo nella penombra vediamo l'eclissi parziale di Sole. Dall'altra parte, quando la Luna si trova dall'altra parte, che diventa rossa per l'eclissi, perché la copriamo noi in quel caso, si trova dalla parte opposta del Sole rispetto alla Terra, e quindi siamo noi a coprirla, a farla andare nel nostro cono d'ombra, e a questo colore, colorazione rossa, l'assume perché riflettiamo noi la luce del Sole sulla nostra atmosfera e la rimbalziamo verso la Luna, nella lunghezza d'onda del rosso, come quando c'è un tramonto. E questa immagine, per esempio, l'eclissi totale di Luna, ripresa proprio dal piazzale di Virgo il 27 luglio del 2018. Questa bellissima foto è stata scattata con i nostri telescopi dell'Associazione Eclissi di Luna, tra l'altro un po' anche lì nuvoloso, comunque abbiamo ripreso almeno alcune immagini. Quindi con Virgo noi spesso collaboriamo proprio per questo tipo di attività, e ci fa molto piacere perché crediamo che la scienza vada portata a tutti i modi e nei linguaggi diversi, scientifici ovviamente, e anzi complimenti anche per le danzatrici, per lo spettacolo precedente, anche per, per i suoni che abbiamo ascoltato, perché comunque sono tutti un multi-messenger del nostro modo di comunicare via terra, che è molto utile a divulgare anche il metodo scientifico, e oggi ce n'è tanto bisogno. In questa immagine vediamo la superficie lunare con i mari che sono ormai colate laviche raffreddate nel tempo da quando si è formata la Luna, e più o meno in questa zona qua è allunata l'Apollo 11 nel 1969, quando l'uomo ha messo per la prima volta piede sulla Luna, si trovava in questa zona qui del Mare della Tranquillità. Le missioni Apollo sono quasi tutte sulla zona centrale qui della Luna, alcune, tipo l'Apollo 15 è andata poi nel Mare della Serenità, sono stati sempre in questa zona e in luoghi un pochino diversi come caratteristiche geologiche della Luna, per cercare di capire di che materiale era costituita, per analizzare poi le rocce. Quindi la Luna è sempre stata, vediamo altri crateri, è sempre stata un sogno per l'umanità, un sogno da raggiungere, un punto, diciamo, io guardo ogni tanto il cielo perché spererei di vedere anche la Luna dal vivo, un sogno da raggiungere perché l'uomo ha sempre sognato di poter raggiungere quell'obiettivo. Il progetto Apollo è arrivato lì ovviamente dopo altri tipi di progetti, io stasera non vi prendo troppo tempo a spiegare tutta la storia dell'astronautica che ha portato l'uomo sulla Luna. Eravamo in un periodo di guerra fredda, per cui negli anni 60, dal 1957, vi faccio qualche un po' di storia, ma pochissima. Von Braun per quanto riguarda la NASA e Korolev per quanto riguarda i russi, sono stati gli uomini che progettavano i razzi che avrebbero dovuto permettere, hanno permesso all'uomo di andare nello spazio fino anche con razzi molto più potenti, come Saturn V, di arrivare sulla Luna. Quindi l'uomo a un certo punto ha iniziato a porsi questo obiettivo seriamente e ha cominciato a lanciare qualcosa nello spazio per capire cosa c'era oltre. Cioè quel sogno che l'umanità probabilmente ha da sempre, che ha spinto l'uomo anche verso un'analisi sempre più curiosa di quella che è l'universo, la sua esistenza, la sua dimensione, ha spinto in avanti anche il pensiero filosofico, a un certo punto ci ha voluto proprio spingere materialmente nello spazio. E nel 57, il 4 ottobre, i russi hanno lanciato il primo satellite in orbita intorno alla Terra, lo Sputnik. Quindi abbiamo iniziato poi a occupare lo spazio intorno a noi, prima vicino alla Terra. Abbiamo iniziato a mandare esseri viventi, Laika, cagnolini, che poi hanno cercato di capire la vita, come si comportava durante il lancio per arrivare nello spazio, cosa sarebbe successo alla vita. E quindi sono stati fatti anche esperimenti, in questo senso, con animali, perché la scienza astronomica aveva bisogno di capire, prima di mandare l'uomo, di capire che cosa sarebbe successo andando a questa velocità, andando a queste pressioni, andando in queste situazioni, nello spazio estremo, che voglio ricordare ancora oggi, forse associamo un po' troppo facilità all'andare oggi nello spazio, ci rendiamo conto di alcune missioni, sembra quasi che lo spazio è un luogo ostile, ci sono temperature ovviamente estreme, molto fredde, c'è il vuoto spinto, anche oggi per la scienza e per l'astronautica non è facile raggiungere lo spazio e attraversarlo. E infatti ci sono state anche tragedie durante questa sperimentazione, questo tentativo dell'uomo di arrivare sulla Luna, fino al 12 aprile 61, in cui Yuri Gagarin è il primo uomo a andare nello spazio. E fin qui i russi erano avvantaggiati, erano avanti rispetto agli americani. Qui c'è il rientro di Yuri Gagarin, che era una sonda praticamente, una sonda automatica, lui non ha fatto assolutamente nulla, è tutto comandato da terra, e doveva essere parachutato prima che arrivasse a terra, altrimenti avrebbe subito ferite mortali nell'atterraggio. Chiaramente gli americani reagiscono il 5 maggio 61 con il discorso del presidente Kennedy, che vuole portare nell'arco di 10 anni l'uomo sulla Luna, e quindi sposta in avanti l'obiettivo, non più lo spazio vicino a noi, ma lo spazio molto più lontano, arrivare fino a quel sogno che l'uomo ha sempre fatto della Luna. Sogno che io vorrei realizzare stasera con il telescopio, ma dubito che ci riusciremo ancora, perché il cielo è molto coperto. E per far questo lanciano il progetto Mercury, cominciano a fare delle missioni che porteranno poi allo sviluppo del Saturn V, quindi nel primo momento avrei saltato tutta una storia, altrimenti occupavamo troppo tempo, e arrivano fino al Saturn V, che è il razzo che ha la particolarità di essere modulare e quindi di poter superare in step diversi il viaggio con successo verso la Luna, e quindi raggiungere poi la velocità di 40.000 km all'ora, che sarebbe poi la velocità che li avrebbe condotti verso il nostro satellite naturale. Furono lanciati ovviamente diversi Saturn, alcuni, i primi sono stati lanciati per sperimentare sia il lancio sia le manovre che devono fare gli astronauti in volo intorno alla Luna, quindi in orbita intorno alla Luna, quindi le manovre per l'aggancio e lo sgancio del modulo di comando dell'EM, cioè la loro astronave che le avrebbe fatti allunare, e le manovre che avrebbe voluto fare poi per il rientro e per l'atterraggio di nuovo a terra. Quindi dopo una serie di esperimenti, alcuni purtroppo sono stati anche per i russi e per gli americani tragici, ricordiamo poi l'incidente dell'Apollo 1, che vediamo se ecco, l'Apollo 1 invece nel 67, purtroppo durante delle prove a terra, tutti gli astronauti perirono un incendio che si sviluppò a bordo, e a causa di questo portellone che non riuscirono ad aprire dall'esterno, fu riprogettato e siamo dovuti poi arrivare al 68-69 per rivedere poi l'Apollo. Aspetta, c'è un problema di connessione che forse... Ecco. Tanto per capirsi, il Saturn 5 è un razzo alto due volte la Torre di Pisa. Per chi ha visto la Torre di Pisa, è un razzo che è un gigante che era diviso in tre stadi, sostanzialmente, e quindi sviluppava la sua potenza per arrivare sulla Luna in tempi diversi. Ora io, ecco, la presentazione, eccola qui, spero che sia andata liscia, perché vedo scatti. E questo concetto di Von Braun è stato il concetto vincente, perché i russi progettavano razzi sempre più potenti, sempre più pesanti, e quella non è stata una strada vincente. Invece gli americani hanno indovinato la logica di fare un razzo modulare in modo che mano a mano si alleggerisse durante il viaggio verso la Luna, e questo ha permesso veramente di realizzare poi una serie di missioni. Vediamo qui l'Apollo 8 con le manovre intorno alla Terra, prima di poi l'Apollo 8 ha fatto la prima volta il giro intorno alla Luna, e quindi non ha fatto assolutamente neanche tentato l'allunaggio, ha provato il viaggio di andata e ritorno. E adesso è saltato forse un po' troppe missioni. Il 20 luglio del 69 il sogno di millenni diventa realtà. L'uomo mette il primo piede sulla Luna con l'Apollo 11. Il 16 luglio del 1969. Il 16 luglio è il lancio, scusate, c'è scritto qui. Il lancio viene fatto il 16 luglio, poi dopo tre giorni o più arrivano sulla Luna questi uomini che hanno fatto, diciamo, il primo viaggio, hanno messo piede sulla Luna. Neil Armstrong ovviamente è stato il primo uomo a mettere piede sulla Luna, e Collins e Aldrin. La frase storica di Neil Armstrong è quella che questo è un piccolo passo per un uomo, ma è un grande balzo per l'umanità, come tutti ricordiamo. Ci sono stati anni in cui queste missioni sono state messe anche in dubbio. Oggi sappiamo, oltretutto ci sono state le sonde recenti, come le JAXA, le sonde giapponesi, cinesi, che hanno fotografato i pezzi che sono rimasti sulla Luna, come i rover, come le basi dell'EM che venivano dopo il lancio, diciamo, verso il modulo di comando per ritornare alla Terra, rimanevano una buona parte della piattaforma, diciamo, di questi LEM rimaneva sulla Luna. Ora qui sono quelli in grigio, sono quelli che non ci sono più, in realtà sono un po' di più quelli che non ci sono più come astronauti. Questi sono gli uomini che hanno compiuto il viaggio e hanno messo piede sulla Luna, alcuni di loro no, diciamo un terzo di loro no, perché rimanevano nel modulo di comando intorno alla Luna. E queste sono le posizioni, la Luna purtroppo non la vediamo stasera, le posizioni dell'Apollo 11, qui nel mare della tranquillità, e poi l'Apollo 12 è andato dalla parte opposta, sotto a Copernico, sotto quasi al cratere, per analizzare rocce nel lato opposto, diciamo, della Luna. L'Apollo 13 non c'è, perché l'Apollo 13 ha subito invece un incidente che ha dovuto costringere la NASA a annullare la missione di allunaggio. Poi l'Apollo 14, Apollo 15, 16 e 17. Le missioni dell'Apollo 16 Apollo 15, 16 e 17 sono state missioni con geologi che avevano anche il compito di raccogliere rocce lunari e analizzare il suolo. Dopo l'Apollo 17 le missioni sono terminate, c'erano ancora 3 razzi che erano pronti per il lancio, in realtà non sono state utilizzate. È stato annullato perché non ha trovato la NASA più interessante andare sulla Luna. Queste foto, per esempio, sono foto fatte con sonde, con l'LRO, dove fotografano appunto le tracce lasciate dal rover dell'Apollo 16 con Charlie Duke, che è stato anche qui a Pisa qualche anno fa in visita all'osservatorio di Libiano con gli amici astrofi dell'Alta Valdera. E quindi vediamo alcuni pezzi, diciamo, delle missioni, della missione Apollo 16. L'Apollo 11, torno un attimino alla Luna, la missione che ha portato l'uomo la prima volta sulla Luna, Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, per primo, diciamo, due di loro, solo in due andavano sulla Luna, piede sulla Luna. Ora qui, se riesco a farvi vedere dei video, vediamo se riesco a mettere... Questo era Apollo 11.
Domenico, il video non lo stiamo vedendo, stiamo vedendo ancora soltanto le tue slides, il PowerPoint, perché stai condividendo allora, l'applicazione PowerPoint, ma non
il video. Vedi il video. Allora fermo. Comunque il video l'abbiamo visto n volte sul discorso perché c'è stato il 50esimo. Ritorniamo allora, ritorno sulla presentazione.
Sì, vai.
Non riesco a far vedere solo il video. Comunque il lancio. Dalla piattaforma il razzo impiegava circa 8 secondi non è troppo veloce. Lo vedi, Valerio, l'immagine?
Sì, le slides le vediamo. Sì.
Ecco, questa qui era saltata un attimo, questa immagine qua. I punti dove si trovano l'Apollo 11, l'Apollo 12, l'Apollo 13, la missione che è fallita, 14, 15, l'Apollo 16, l'immagine sotto l'Apollo 17. E anche qui in ogni missione sono stati ripresi i vari oggetti che erano stati lasciati poi sulla Luna. Eagle, l'Aquila, nello stemma dell'Apollo 11, è anche il nome dell'M. Eagle, che è praticamente la navicella che ha portato gli uomini sulla Luna. Dicevo, il razzo Apollo Saturn 5 impiega circa 8 secondi per lasciare la rampa prima di prendere velocità. E l'unico pezzo che poi rientra qua, dove stiamo gli astronauti, di tutto questo razzo, l'unico pezzetto che rientra da Terra è la parte degli astronauti, questa parte qua su in cima del razzo. Questo invece è un razzo di salvataggio, nel caso ci fosse stato un problema avrebbero premuto un bottone per far allontanare gli astronauti dal razzo, se fosse in caso di scoppio, in caso di problema. Dicevo, lo spazio è un ambiente ostile, lo è ovviamente sempre, e per andare sulla Luna hanno dovuto superare problemi che riguardavano la temperatura, per esempio. Da quando la parte, diciamo, di spostazione presenta temperature di 150-170,
Domenico, abbiamo perso il tuo audio, non ti sentiamo più. Aspettiamo qualche istante se l'audio di Domenico ritorna.
Vediamo se riesco a...
Ah, Domenico, ora
ti... Io ce l'ho attivo.
Sì, ora ti risentiamo. No, era sparito, forse perché hai dei problemi un po' di connessione.
E siccome sono fuori col telescopio, può darsi che sono nel wifi, non sono col cavo, e può darsi che abbia qualche problema di linea.
Sì, si sente molto male, molto a scatti, molto male.
andare, vediamo se vado più piano, non faccio troppe manovre, perché anche la slide magari, questa è un'immagine della Luna vista dal modulo di comando, quando ruotava verso, aprivano gli sportelli, prima Terra in questo modo, come un unico pianeta, un'unica sfera blu in quel nero dello spazio profondo. E questo invece è il modulo di comando nel momento in cui è in orbita intorno alla Luna e in cui rimaneva uno degli astronauti per controllare poi la missione, per poi il rientro dei due che scendevano sulla Luna. Questa è un'immagine della Terra vista dalla Luna, mentre dal modulo di comando che è in orbita intorno alla Luna, e questo è l'M quando si stacca dal modulo di comando per andare a allunare, diciamo, con i due astronauti che sono all'interno, visto dall'oblò del modulo di comando. Ecco, alcune di queste immagini sono state scattate proprio durante le missioni Apollo. Qui vediamo i crateri, a sua volta crateri che sono dentro ad altri crateri. Valerio, mi stai sentendo ora?
Sì, sì, adesso sì. Anche se stiamo, diciamo, ci abbiamo pochi minuti, diciamo.
Sì, adesso io vado verso la conclusione. Niente video, questa è sempre l'immagine della Terra, il LEM. Altre immagini della Luna, avrei voluto far vedere i crateri dal vivo. Ci sarà altra occasione con Virgo anche di fare qualche attività dal vivo, speriamo presto. E questa è l'immagine reale della NASA.
Domenico, abbiamo perso di nuovo l'audio.
Sentite ora?
Ora ti sentiamo, sì, però non benissimo.
Questo ovviamente è la bandiera, io avrei, ovviamente se c'ero io avrei messo il logo di ACA, invece loro hanno messo giustamente la bandiera americana, cioè mi sembra giusto, e per sostenerla, diciamo in questo modo, qui c'era una stecca d'alluminio che anche se non c'era vento, l'atmosfera ovviamente stava bella stesa, abbastanza stesa per poter mostrare la bandiera. Poi sulla Luna sono stati lasciati diversi strumenti, alcuni di questi comunicano ovviamente con la Terra per prendere anche misure direttamente dalla Luna verso la Terra, e le missioni successive hanno portato a casa circa 600 kg di roccia. Sull'EM, sul piede dell'EM, c'è questa targa, ricordo, della prima volta l'uomo è sceso sulla Luna, e con la firma degli astronauti che l'hanno visitata. Questo è l'arrivo poi degli astronauti a Terra, quando poi vengono recuperati dalla capsula. Anche allora, qui si è perso un'immagine, ve lo fa vedere, anche allora venivano, anche loro hanno dovuto subire una quarantena perché non sapevano se ci poteva essere qualche virus o qualche Covid che poteva creare dei problemi al rientro degli astronauti a Terra, e quindi hanno passato i loro 40 giorni in quarantena isolati dalle altre persone. Apollo 12, poi l'Apollo 13 invece è quella che ha avuto un problema di scoppio di uno dei serbatoi dell'ossigeno, e quindi poi hanno è stata una missione Houston We Have a Problem, è stata la frase famosa pronunciata dagli astronauti quando ho sentito il botto all'interno del modulo di comando. Per fortuna non aveva ancora sganciato il LEM, e hanno, diciamo, utilizzato poi l'EM e l'energia dell'EM per recuperare e girare intorno alla Luna e ritornare verso Terra, si sono salvati. È stata poi una missione che è fallita per quello che era la missione, ma di successo perché è riuscita a portare gli astronauti a Terra in una situazione abbastanza critica. Apollo 13, quel 13 gli ha giocato un pochino male in quell'occasione, anche se poi alla fine è andato tutto bene, diciamo. Questa era l'esplosione del serbatoio dal modulo di comando che l'hanno fotografato proprio gli astronauti quando si sono staccati con il LEM e hanno potuto vedere il danno del modulo di comando. Questo è un dettaglio della discesa dell'EM verso la Luna. Un aneddoto è che Neil Armstrong guidò il LEM manualmente, perché i computer erano impazziti in quel momento, verso una zona pianeggiante. Questa è un'altra immagine famosa, qui la vedete Shepard che lancia con una racchetta, era appassionato di golf, e lanciò, fece un tiro di una pallina al golf con la sua firma sulla Luna, perché voleva vedere con un sesto di gravità dove arrivava questa pallina. Fu anche abbastanza ripreso dalla NASA per questa cosa, perché la racchetta era telescopica, era allungabile, era stata nascosta nella tuta Apollo 15 iniziano le missioni con il rover, una macchina che costava solo 6 milioni di dollari allora, negli anni 70. A proposito di Apollo 13, ricorre il 50esimo quest'anno, ad aprile è stato, diciamo, il 50esimo di quando hanno fatto la missione. Quindi ora, nei prossimi due anni, avremo la ricorrenza di altre missioni, il 50esimo di tutte le altre missioni, fino all'Apollo 17. Questo è Charlie Duke dell'Apollo 16, vicino a un cratere, il rover qua in lontananza. Io, siccome non riesco a farvi vedere la Luna, ho messo delle immagini giusto per... Questa è la famiglia di Charlie Duke, una foto lasciata dall'astronauta sulla superficie lunare. Il LEM, questa parte del LEM poi ritorna verso il modulo di comando e questa parte, la base, rimane invece sulla Luna. Apollo 17 è l'ultima missione dell'uomo verso la Luna. Chiaramente poi ho visto prima la presentazione di altre ipotesi di stazioni lunari che, qui vediamo un po' di immagini, missioni che saranno in futuro, perché la Luna è diventata di nuovo interessante per l'esplorazione spaziale. Queste sono le missioni Apollo, tutte insieme, e i luoghi, i siti, diciamo, di allunaggio delle varie missioni. E questa Apollo 13.
Ho finito. Non so la situazione attuale del meteo com'è.
Per me è tutto nuvolo, è tutto coperto.
Ho capito. Non so se vuoi in chiusura dire semplicemente se avete degli appuntamenti in programma, delle attività del tuo gruppo, eventualmente.
Allora, il gruppo è a Cascina. Intanto saluto, approfitto per salutare sia le Astrofili che sia tutta Cascina per tutti quelli che poi ci vengano a trovare sul territorio. Cerchiamo di fare attività sul sito astrofilicascinesi.it, potete trovare poi il programma. Noi le attività al momento sono sospese, attività pubbliche. Cercheremo di fare invece le attività in remoto e quindi faremo delle lezioni in remoto. Ricordo che con Virgo anche abbiamo fatto attività, cerchiamo di fare altre attività con persone che hanno disabilità, con i non vedenti, ma anche disabilità intellettive, come abbiamo fatto anche qualche volta lì a Virgo. Quindi nei prossimi settimane pensiamo di mettere in programma delle attività proprio di in remoto, in Zoom, che vediamo quale piattaforma. Quindi dal sito potete collegarvi o dalla pagina Facebook, in modo da far vivere qualche emozione, anche se ognuno a casa propria, dal vivo, con i telescopi, andando sul territorio, compreso Virgo, è una delle tappe che facciamo ogni tanto, o sul nostro territorio di Cascina e non solo. Mi approfitto ancora per ringraziare Virgo, la notte dei ricercatori, a cui partecipiamo sempre volentieri, e vi porto il saluto di tutto il consiglio dell'Associazione Cascina Astrofili e di tutti gli amici astrofili che ci seguono. Quindi grazie e complimenti per tutto questo evento, anche questo purtroppo fatto in remoto, ma che comunque ha la sua valenza, la sua importanza, la sua bellezza.
Grazie a te, Domenico.
Grazie mille, grazie Domenico. Era molto, molto interessante. Le tue slides ti ho scritto sono straordinarie. Sì, possiamo averle, sono veramente una bella storia. Una bella storia.
Ok, Stavros, se vuoi dire due parole.
Grazie. Thank you very much. Grazie, mille grazie, Domenico.
Thank you.
Diciamo, thank you, Domenico. Dunque, voglio dire grazie a tutti che hanno seguito, al team, Vincenzo, Valerio, Paola, Giuseppe, anche Saroglia che non era con noi, e penso che non ho dimenticato qualcuno. Era veramente, per me era una sorpresa, l'abbiamo fatto così, ma penso che era un'emozione, era una conoscenza, era molto molto interessante. Io ho seguito, non so se sono il solo, ma di avere piacere queste cose che abbiamo visto, ma era veramente... Dunque, grazie a tutti. L'anno prossimo, forse più spesso, più dunque Paola parla di della primavera, vediamo. Dunque, grazie, mille grazie a tutti. Grazie. Bene.